Hi, you've reached the High Fashion Hotline.
Hi, my family's going to a picnic, but our clothes are stained.
That's quite a pickle.
Ketchup, actually. We want to look amazing.
Go to Old Navy.
Old Navy?
Yep, right now get up to 50% off all tees, all tanks, all shorts, and all dresses at Old Navy and OldNavy.com.
All up to 50% off?
Yes, get tees and tanks from $6 for adults, $5 for kids, and dresses start at $15 for women, $10 for girls.
Hey, everyone, we're going to Old Navy.
High Fashion, Old Navy.
Valid 6/21 to 6/27. Excludes clearance, jewelry, active, flat tees and tanks, licensed, and men's package tops.
Hey, folks, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Laura.
Folks, I love cupcakes. I love them, love them, love them. And so does Laura. Don't you, Laura? You love cupcakes,
yummy,
right?
Yummy, yummy.
Who doesn't? Who doesn't? What could be better than watching wrestling than having a wrestling-inspired cupcake? Folks, let me tell you. Check out Turnbuckle Cupcakes for a one-of-a-kind treat or a unique gift for the wrestling fan in your life. They have everything from amazing cupcakes to one-of-a-kind crochet fandom items. They should make a Bunkhouse Bob cupcake. I'm just saying. Folks, check out Turnbuckle Cupcakes on Facebook or visit www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com.
This is Matt Hardy, and you are listening to Live from the Armory, the podcast. And Live from the Armory is where I actually promoted my first ever Omega event in 1993.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
Maybe I ought to just change the name of the show to the Caleb Conley Show.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605 with your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
I don't sign autographs. I'm not, and I very, very rarely take pictures with people, but if people insist and they're nice, then I'll do that, so.
And the lovely Laura.
I am a true and total lady. I would never headbutt anybody.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is Bunkhouse Bob, and I am the co-host of this program. And joining me in just a moment, as she does each and every week, will be the lovely Laura. Folks, this is episode 139 of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, and we thank you very much for tuning in tonight, wherever you're listening to the program at, however you're listening to it. If you catch this thing as we do it live on Blog Talk Radio, like we do every Wednesday night, 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock Eastern Time. If you hear it streamed worldwide at www.fnx.network, if you catch us on the iTunes podcast app, if you have that app, and you go to the podcast section, type in Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, you can subscribe to it. It'll download automatically. You can do the same thing with Stitcher. We're also on Stitcher. Go to www.stitcher.com. And you can search the show there, and you can download and subscribe to it and listen to it as you doze off tonight or tomorrow at work while you're goofing off. Instead of working, you can goof off with us. And I've been thinking, folks, the most important thing for you to know tonight is this. Perhaps next week, instead of calling it the Caleb Conley Show, we'll start calling this the George South Show. Just saying. Just saying. Folks, we got two great guests for you tonight. Coming up here in about 20 minutes, we're going to have Mr. Richie Steamboat. And don't ask the stupid question. Just think about it for a minute. His name is Richie Steamboat. Coming up in the 8 o'clock hour, really excited to have this lady on the show. Been working diligently to get her on the program. One of the premier up-and-coming talents. I don't want to say up-and-coming. She is one of the premier talents of the women's West Coast wrestling scene. Holidead will be with us in her very first podcast. She'll be up in the 8 o'clock hour. Folks, we would encourage you to check out our good friends at Top Rope Belts, www.topropebelts.com. Check out our good friends at Turnbuckle Cupcakes. You can find them on Facebook. Search Turnbuckle Cupcakes or go to www.turnbucklecupcakes.storenv.com. I would remind everybody that there are 52 days to WrestleCade. 52. Go to www.wrestlecade.com. Get all the info, all the ticket information you can for WrestleCade. This show 100% supports hashtag Project Kindness, and we also support Project Pile Drive Hunger. And without any more from me, we'd like to welcome to the show the heart and the soul of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. She is also going to school to become a pilot for the Vanguard Air Force. We'd like to welcome back to the program the lovely Laura.
Yes, Bob, I have enlisted in the Broken Army.
You have you?
I have. No more schmat party for me.
No, you're all in now, huh?
I am all in.
The dust has settled from
crazy.
The Great War, huh?
It just took Matt Hardy going crazy.
Matt Hardy went crazy. Jeff Hardy went crazy.
Oh my God!
Ribby went crazy. The internet went crazy. I told people.
Well, can I ask you a question? Because I don't know this. Of course, I knew who Willow was, but what the hell was he the first time when he dunked him in the water? What was that?
When he come up with the tie and the cigarette?
No. I know what he was doing there, but I'm talking about on Bound for Glory. When the first time he dunked him, he came up with these huge goggles on his head. And it kind of reminded me of, like, somebody from, like, the Teen Titans. But I didn't understand who he was supposed to be the first time that Crazy Steve dunked him in the water.
Coles, get on that. Maybe it was a play oh, crap. What's her name? Becky Lynch's goggles.
Well, I thought about her, too. But then I thought, well, what the hell is that? And, of course, I knew who Willow was. And it takes – all right, let me just say this real quick, ladies and gentlemen. Let me tell you how powerful Matt Hardy is. And some dude on a podcast said this, and I do apologize. I don't know what podcast it was. But this is how powerful Matt Hardy is. He's gotten over a gardener, a baby, a drone, Willow. I mean, I didn't think anybody could get Willow over. His wife and himself. Mm-hmm. That's the hardest working man in wrestling right there, folks.
You ain't lying. He put out a tweet that I thought was pretty funny, where he talked about him and a few other people reinvented what would now be known as the ladder match, or a tables, ladders, and chairs match, and he has reinvented himself again, reinvented wrestling again. And reading the Twitter machine throughout that night, whether you liked it or whether you hated it, it was trending, the Great War, Broken Matt Hardy, the whole thing. People's eyes were glued to it. He entertained. They did what they were supposed to do. They put asses in seats, and at the end of the day, that's what it was all about.
Most certainly, and I love the fact that it's like a B-horror movie, or just a B-movie, period.
Just a B-movie, period.
I'm expecting John Waters to show up at some point in some of these vignettes, because, I mean, this is just the best shit ever. And people are like, oh, I don't like it. You don't understand it. That's the problem. There's enough people who do, and you know, wow. Just absolutely wow. It's the best. That's why I bought the pay-per-view and to see Caleb Conley, which I still haven't.
Missing in action.
Yeah, what the hell?
Maybe he's at pilot school. Maybe he's learning how to fly.
Well, the Revolt might need to join the Broken Army. I'm just saying.
Yeah, the Broken Revolt Army. It'd be
the Broken
gigantic
Revolt
gimmick.
Army.
Might be gigantic gimmick infringement, for sure.
I've already been accused of gimmick infringement for that missing posters. That's all right.
That's okay. Well, before we get more infringed upon, why don't you give out the social media so if people can tweet along and we'll see what happens tonight in social media land.
You can tweet along with me at From the Armory tonight, and you can tweet along with me in my regular everyday life at Circle Sky. You can tweet along with old Bunkhouse Bob here. Convert. That's right. At Bob_Delp, we have two Facebook pages. We have the official Live from the Armory Facebook page, which you can find at facebook.com/live.armory.9. And fans of Live from the Armory, it's a closed group. We do let people in if you're respectable and respected, and you show us respect. And also, we have a YouTube page. You can type in Live from the Armory, and you can see what we have uploaded, which we need to. We always say this every week, Bob, but we need to do better. We got to do better. You know?
We got to do better. That's why we can't have nice things, because we're lazy.
Yeah.
We're lazy.
That's it right there.
And when it comes to it. There's too much to do. That's the problem. There's too much to do.
God,
social media and yeah, all that other junk. But at any rate, the whole Great War thing was over big. I didn't really see a whole lot. We'll read down some indie events and do some other stuff here in just a second. There was one tidbit that I did see that I thought was worth noting, because I really didn't watch a lot this week. I got caught up in some other stuff. But did you see where it was reported that Justin Gabriel, also known as PJ Black, most notably of Lucha Underground, with the Worldwide Underground or Underground Worldwide, broke both of his legs in a base jumping accident in South Africa? Yeah, I caught that. I was trying to think when that came across. I think it came across Sunday night or Monday night, something like that. He was doing base jumping in his home country, South Africa, and broke both of his ankles. So certainly want to wish him a speedy recovery. I don't know how speedy you can be at recovering from that, but that puts a wrinkle, perhaps, in what had been planned in Lucha Underground. I don't know. I don't know if the entire season has been taped yet. I don't know. I didn't think that it was, but certainly hope that he... certainly hope that he gets better, and we'll go from there. But
I guess you saw where Jamie Noble had been stabbed, and
that is the craziest shit in the world.
I have been in that trailer park repossessing cars. I used to repossess cars for a living. I've been in that trailer park. It ain't no joke. In West Virginia is the town where John and I saw people burning a refrigerator.
Well. I mean, here's the only thing I can say. I mean, the headline that came across was kind of shady to start with. You know, Jamie Noble stabbed in trailer park. It makes it sound like he was, you know, hanging out with Cecil and Bubba and the boys. And
that's
not really what happened. Well, yeah, but I mean, that's not the, the innuendo was there. He was a victim of road rage. Some dude cut him off or something like that, pulled him behind of him. He got out of the car and... you know, whatever, and the next thing you know, he gets stabbed twice.
And the
I guess he posted some pictures. I didn't look at the pictures, but I guess he posted pictures of the injuries and all that other stuff.
No.
Hold on a second. We're gonna take this call real quick here. Hold on 1 second. Let's see here. See, 213, you're on with Live from the Armory Wrestling Show.
Hello, Bob. Going to see how you're doing.
Oh, I'm absolutely fabulous tonight. I've got, you know, there was something that people have been asking me a lot. They say, you know, Bob, you're pretty set in your ways. You don't change a lot. I mean, you don't change your delivery. You don't change the format of the show. You don't change this. You don't change that. Well, I am actually going to change something. I'm going to change my mind. I've had a change of heart because we're not going to talk to you tonight. I lied. I'm always constantly accused of being a liar on this program. I lied. We're not going to talk to you tonight. I actually feel pretty good. I actually feel great. I don't care whether or not the listeners are concerned. I don't care if Laura knows what conversion disorder is or isn't. I don't care. So I'm cutting this all short, and I hope you have a nice life.
Bob, I can't believe you did this. I can't believe.
I can't believe you. I like this, Bob. I'm so upset, not for myself, but I'm worried about you, and you're deceiving yourself. I think you're only feeling better because you're in denial, Bob, and I'm your only hope. You know you're on. I'm so confused right now. I'm your only hope, Bob. I'm so upset. I'm so worried about you, but I promise I'll keep a close eye on you over the next week, Bob. And I really hope the heat patches that you bought for your shoulder help you feel better. Bob,
What did you just say to me?
I said that I hope heat patches that you bought for your shoulder help you feel better, because I'm concerned that now you're denying your conversion disorder, and it's only going to get worse.
Nope.
And
I haven't said anything. Hold on. I haven't said shit to anybody about that. How do you know about that?
I told you, Bob, I've been watching you because I'm concerned, because no one else understands what you're going through. But I do, because I know about these things.
No. I'm done. Thanks, buddy. Don't call back into the show. Thank you.
Holy shit.
I didn't say shit to anybody about that.
You got yourself a stalker, Bob.
Won't you read some indie events? I'm going to take a break.
All right, I think that's probably the best idea that you've had in a while. CZW has free TV tapings. Tickets are first come, first served. Peeps, Saturday, October 8th at the Flyer Skate Zone in Voorhees, New Jersey. You can find out more information by visiting www.czwrestling.com. Atomic Championship Wrestling, featuring Rogue Women Warriors, presents Pandemonium Saturday, October 8th at the Stevens Fire Company Hall in Stevens, Pennsylvania. You can find out more information by visiting www.atomicprowrestling.com. Reality Wrestling has TV tapings this Saturday, October the 8th at the World Gym Arena in Texas City, Texas. You can find out more information by visiting www.realityofwrestling.com. And poor Bob.
Oh. I'm back.
You okay?
No, not really. Be honest with you. But we'll get through it. I don't like Laura. I haven't said anything to anybody about that. I pulled a muscle in my shoulder like a week ago, and it's been really bothering me. And I told my wife, whom I don't mention on this show, that if it wasn't any better by the end of this week, that I was going to go to the doctor and see if there's something, if I pulled something, if there's something. And
right.
I've been putting some heat cream on it. And
you didn't mention
either. No, I went and I got some back patches because, you know, it's constant heat, cut them in half, and I put them in, putting them on my shoulder.
Right.
And I haven't told anybody about that. So, that's all. Folks, we're just waiting on Richie Steamboat to call in. He's supposed to be calling in here in a couple more minutes. We're really excited to get Richie on the show. And we're obviously going to talk to him about some of the things that happened with WWE and NXT and the injury and all that. There's been a gap, so to speak, from Richie in talking to the media and letting people know what's been going on with him. So we'll talk to him about that in just a few moments. I know a lot of people have been messaging me and putting stuff up on the Facebook page wanting to know about TNA and all this, and I promise you folks, at the end of the show, I'm going to give you the information that I have about TNA, about TNA's affiliation with WWE, if there is a fix-in with Dixie Carter and Vince McMahon. There's a lot of rumors going around, a lot of innuendo, but I'm going to separate the fact from the fiction, and we're going to let folks know what's really going on to the best of our knowledge with TNA here after we get done with all the interviews. How was your week this week?
It wasn't too bad. Saw a lot of indie action over the weekend. I know that fair season's still going on, and lots of people are out doing the fair thing. And, you know, PWX has got a show coming up. AML's got some great shows coming up. The second annual Cornette Cup's coming up. Lots of great stuff. I mean, it's just really incredible how it's all coming together. And, you know, I've got to sit down and make a WrestleCade list, because now I've got to sell my other kidney, because, damn, Ron Simmons is going to be there.
Ron Simmons, Matt Cross was just announced before we went on air. So there's a lot of stuff going on. But speaking of going on, I want to go on and if I've got this right, I hope that I have this right, I'd like to go on and bring on our first guest this evening. I'm really excited to talk to this guy. Without any further ado for me, if I have this correct, we would like to welcome to the show Richie Steamboat. Richie, are you there, sir?
I am, and I'm glad to be here. Thank you for having me.
How you doing tonight, man? You doing okay?
Oh, I'm doing great. I'm doing awesome. I'm back here on my patio with my family and enjoying the wonderful Carolina weather.
Very good. Well, I was going to mention this at the top of the show. Obviously, for our friends and our listeners that are in the Florida, Georgia, North Carolina, South Carolina area, could be some weather passing through. You guys want to make sure that you're prepared and heed any warnings if they're announced by your local officials. Hurricanes, at least from where I live, are not anything to mess around with, and I know a little something about hurricanes, so please take note of that. Obviously, Richie, joining us on the other end of the line is Laura. Laura, you want to say hello to Richie?
Hey, Richie, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Laura. How are you tonight?
Doing just fine. Now that we've got you on the show, it's an honor to have you on.
Yes.
Well, thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Richie, we'll go on and get started. And what I wanted to start with is I wanted to talk to you about 2012, if we could.
You had
been FCW heavyweight champion. You were ranked 99 in the PWI 500. You had been placed in a program with Cassius Ohno, a.k.a. Chris Hero. Looking at 2012 before the injury, what was a day in the life of Richie Steamboat like?
It was busy. It was very, very busy. You know, I feel very fortunate and humbled by all the experiences that I've been able to accomplish throughout my wrestling career. And in 2012, we had a lot going on. SCW was changing to officially NXT. We had a new facility being built in Orlando. That is top-notch and has basically every advantage humanly possible for a wrestler to become a superstar. All the talent and all the tools to make that happen. And I personally was doing interviews and was preparing myself for the next step and was just really, honestly, just enjoying the moment because it was an exciting time for me, and I'm sure the fans enjoyed it too.
Yeah, I mean, it was the talk of wrestling, you know, the unveiling of the Performance Center, the NXT changeover. Fans were really excited. Buzz started to generate about what was going on. It was a big deal, and still is a big deal. But in November, go ahead. I'm
it definitely
sorry,
was a it, it that's okay. It definitely was a huge deal, and it was something. Knew that they were bringing to Full Sail University too. They were, you know, in connection with WWE and working together on this idea that they had, and it took right off. And you know, I just couldn't appreciate the opportunity more. They basically had given me the reins and was putting a lot of faith in me, and a lot of hard work and dedication had paid off, and I was so excited to be a part of it. A very exciting time for me and everything going on in WWE and NXT, like you said, everything was new and exciting, and it still is. It's still an awesome product, and everything new and exciting they have coming up. They've got a lot of new talent that they're bringing up through the ranks through the NXT program, and for me it was just it was another stepping stone. It was another path that I had to cross, another street I had to cross
to get to where I wanted to be. And I was focused, and I was ready for that challenge. And unfortunately, as everyone knows, you know, I suffered an injury to my back that took me out of action mid-story with Cassius Ohno, and I was unable to continue. And that basically summed that up at the time.
Right. Now, I want to talk about that. November of 2012, you have your last televised match at NXT takes place. It's reported that you suffered a back injury. For clarification, what type of injury did you incur? And some people were confused as to when you were no longer with WWE. I mean, how does that look, Richie? How did that conversation go when, you know, everybody, all the parties are sitting down there saying, you know, this is what we see, this is what you see? How does that work?
Well, I first would like to say that WWE is an amazing company, and they
sure.
gave me every opportunity in the world and have supported me through the entire journey of my wrestling career and beyond. First of all, they're a great company to work for. I actually had suffered that injury a few weeks earlier and at a house show at FCW down in Tampa, Florida, and had been dealing with it and trying to make things work. And I did a moonsault off the top rope and landed on, I remember his name correctly, he was a ring announcer. He did some other wrestling. I can't think of it at the time, but it was just a house show at FCW.
Mm-hmm.
And I did a moonsault and I landed incorrectly and I lost feeling and everything from my chin down.
Wow.
Immediately. And I could move everything, but I couldn't feel anything.
Mm-hmm.
And that happened to be, you know, I basically told the referee, I said, that's it, I'm done. And I, that was the end of the match. And I rolled out of the ring and immediately went to our medical staff at WWE, which is the same, at FCW, which is the same at WWE. Whenever we have a show, they always had WWE medical staff for the event.
Okay.
So I dealt with that injury for a few weeks, and feelings started to come back to me within probably about 6 to 8 hours. And, you know, I still had a whole heck of a lot of pain. And I didn't want to give up my position. And I knew my role at WWE and the position that they had put me in. And, you know, I've always been a fighter. And in the sense that, you know, adversity and difficult tasks, you know, are no stranger to me. I've lived in Japan in a dojo for 6 months for Pro Wrestling Noah and gone through 1,000 squats a day for 6 months straight. It's that to me was just a bump in the road. And
right.
when I realized that was something that I definitely needed further attention to, after that match, I did decide to sideline myself and go up to Pittsburgh and get some further medical advice and get some decisions made. So, and having done that, I have 3 herniated discs in my back,
mm-hmm.
and they were able to do some work and get some of that fixed. I'll tell you this, I feel great right now. I've been lucky enough to take some time away from the sport and really heal and spend some time with my family. And I honestly, I feel great. I mean, I'm about 215 pounds, working out 5 days a week, not 7 days like I used to. But,
right.
You know, definitely wrestling has been such a part of my life, as you know. Even as a kid, my dad,
sure.
Ricky the Dragon
sure.
Steamboat,
right.
I was at almost every event I could possibly be at, and I was behind the scenes you know, playing with the other kids or messing with the wrestlers. And, you know, it's just part of my life. And it's hard to just not want to be a part of it. You know,
right. After turn it
been,
off.
It means so much to you. You know, wrestling is the love of my life. And besides my wife and my son, and I have another son on the way.
This due right now in March.
Thank you. Cool. Due in March of this of next year. So we're really excited about that. But you know, I needed some time for my family. Growing up, my dad was, you know, gone a lot and did a lot of he sacrificed a lot for his family and for his passion and his love. And you know, after talking with the doctors and everything, the best decision for me at the time wasn't to stick it out and to push through. It was to kind of take a step back and figure out what we need to do to fix the problem. And that way that, you know, there could be a future.
Right.
So that's what I've been really focusing on. I do a lot of yoga. I do a lot of stretching. When I was recovering from surgeries, I obviously did physical therapies and all of that. But I'll tell you this, to all the listeners out there, everybody that loves wrestling as much as I do and loves the sport, never give up on your dream. Never give up on your goals, because hard work always pays off. And,
that's,
you know, I think I'm a testament to that. You know, I really think after almost being a paraplegic, paralyzed from the chin down, they told me I was very close to being in a wheelchair the rest of my life.
Wow.
To come back to the point to where I feel like, you know, I feel great. You know, I really do. I don't have very much back pain anymore. It's definitely manageable, and I'm gaining weight again. And it's just a process. And I wanted to take time away because I wanted to spend time with my family.
Sure.
My wife just graduated from law school, and she's now passed the bar, and she's an official attorney.
Woohoo!
So we're trying to build a thank you very much. We're trying to build a little empire here.
I know.
I understand. You mentioned it briefly, Richie, and obviously we'd be remiss if we didn't mention it. You know, obviously you grew up in the wrestling business, and yes, George South, I know who Richie Steamboat is, unlike some other people who may not know who you are or whom your father is. We're well familiar with that. Most people are familiar with you accompanying to your father to the ring when you were younger. Is there a particular moment or memory that stands out to you or holds a personal meaning to you in that era of larger-than-life characters, Richie?
You know, I have so many memories of my childhood and being with the greatest athletes in the world. I feel, again, so humbled and lucky to be a part of that small group of people that got to experience the family aspect of that. And I have so many fond memories, and I'll tell you, the one memory that really, really sticks out in my mind, and I don't know why this is, the last match that my dad ever wrestled. And it was with Steve Austin.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember the city that we were in, but I do remember in the front row with my mom and our families, and everyone knew, we all knew this was going to be his last match. I'm not sure if it was announced yet, but we all knew it was going to be his last match, and he was retiring. And for me, I wish, you know, that was in 94, so I was probably about 6 or 7 years old, probably 7 years old at the time. For me, looking back, I wish I was a little older and I could really, you know, dive into it a little bit more, because still as a kid, I was looking at it as my dad. You know, the maturity level wasn't quite there to understand everything. So I wish I would have been a little bit older. But I'll tell you, that one moment in that match, Steve Austin, and as you know, my dad helped Steve Austin so much in his early career, mm-hmm. and helped
Right.
He didn't form who Steve Austin is, but he definitely helped his in-ring abilities and took him under his wing, per se, and really helped him become that superstar that he is.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I don't remember that particular match, but I remember the feud going on with the Hollywood Blondes. I remember that.
Right.
That your dad had. I remember that. That was good stuff. I mean, it's classic stuff. You mentioned it a little bit in your previous question, Richie. I mean, you've recently resurfaced on social media with the mantra of fans first. You're making appearances at promotions. I have to ask, Richie, what exactly are you up to? Are you contemplating a return to pro wrestling? I hear the positivity in your voice. I hear, you know, I'm feeling a lot better. I'm this, I'm that. What exactly are you up to, young man?
Well, you know, I've been asked that question a lot lately. And yes, I have kind of resurfaced on social media. And I, to be quite honest with you, I've missed the sport and I've missed being a part of it. And as of right now, I am doing personal appearances and I just want to be involved in the wrestling business. I love the fans. I love everything about the business. I love the people. Now I'm not going to answer your question. I don't know, what may hold the future, but as of right now, at this moment, all I'm going to do is personal appearances. So I'm feeling good. I'm getting healthy. My back feels good. But, you know, I also have to weigh my, you know, I want to make sure my family is first. So whatever decisions I make, it's kind of going to be a family decision.
Sure. I understand that completely. Laura, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Let me get my computer going here. You know, I can remember when your father would bring you and your mother out to the ring, which tells my age a little bit. You were such an adorable baby. What goes through your head when you see photos or footage of you and your parents during that time?
It brings back great memories. It was an amazing time just to be a part of it. And a lot of people ask me questions like, what is it like to be the son of Ricky the Dragon Steamboat? What is it like to be in that limelight that everywhere we went, you know, somebody, whether we were at dinner or at a restaurant, somebody was always stopping, five or six people, maybe even more, were wanting pictures or autographs or things like that. People would always ask me, you know, what is it like to be the son of somebody like that? My answer has always been the same, and it will never change. You know, to me, he's just my dad.
Right.
He's just my dad. I am so proud and honored to have lived in his presence and with him and see the hard work and the commitment that he's put into this, to the sport and to his life and to everything that he's ever done. And that's made me who the man I am today. And, you know, I'm just, you know, he's just my dad to me and my mom. They're just my mom. It's just,
right. Just mom and
just
dad.
Like, you know, yeah, just mom and dad, you know, come over, have dinner, say hi, you know, bring Christmas presents for the kids. So it's, you hear my little boy in the background. So, you know, and that's how I've always felt about it. And it's just an amazing thing. I'm just so happy and proud to be a part of it. And it is the sport, and my dad has touched so many people's lives, and that means so much to me more than anything else. You know, my father had a brain aneurysm at a WrestleMania. He wrestled Chris Jericho and got hurt. He was 56 years old, and he came back and he had a Legends match.
He was
really injured. Was in critical condition for 4 weeks in the hospital.
Oh, my.
And, you know, everything gets put in perspective when things like that happen. And, you know, he's done a lot of – he's sacrificed a lot for the fans and for his family. And I just appreciate him so much. I love him to death, man. I tell you what, my parents are the best. They really are. And they're just like anyone else's parents. You know, I have plenty of friends, and their parents are the same as mine. There's no difference.
Right.
There's no, you know, I just I'm just very fortunate and blessed to be in this family.
Well, Ricky Steamboat was one of my mother's favorite wrestlers. And whenever Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling would come on and he would be on, the world would stop, seriously. And I've met your dad. I met him at WrestleCade last year. Just a truly, truly great guy. Absolutely, truly. You can't... I've never heard anyone say anything bad about your dad, you know, as far as in wrestling, nobody. And George South loves him, let me tell you that. George South absolutely loves your dad. I mean, I know you know that, but, you know.
And I'll tell you, George. My dad loves George South. He trusted George South with his only son to begin his wrestling career.
He sure did.
My first training was done by George South. I remember my third match ever. I went 45 minutes with George South.
Boy.
Just like Tessa Blanchard did.
45 minutes at the Mooresville Armory in front of six people. And that's the guy's
awesome.
Honest truth.
Yep.
Awesome. You know, my dad... has always gone to bat for George, and George has always been an awesome guy. You know, their characters are not far apart. They're the same person.
Right.
Good-hearted, hard-working people, and appreciate everything that they've ever been given. You know, and that's kind of the connection that they made when they crossed paths back in the day when they were all wrestling
right.
together. You know, and my dad has always, like you said, he's really been just an outstanding person. He's you know, there's been so many horrible stories that I've heard and things that have happened in the past, and you know, there is something to be said about his character. He is quite a man.
Yes.
Most certainly. And you know, with everything going on in TNA, I would be remiss not at least bringing this up. You know, you were a trailblazer for babies in wrestling. I think King Maxwell owes all of his success and fame to you.
Oh, well, I don't know if I can take credit for everything. But I'll tell you, every time that I step into the ring, my goal is to have an awesome match, is to have an amazing match, and to give the fans their money's worth. Whatever that entails, if that involves, you know, I've had countless staples in the head and stitches and broken bones and obviously, you know, herniated discs and PCL in one of my legs and this and that. And honestly, to me personally, that's a sacrifice that I made, because I'd made the decision to do what I did, and I don't regret any of it. And I did it for that feeling, because when you're in that ring and you have those fans behind you, because without the fans, we're nothing. Without those people in those seats cheering for us or booing us, we are nothing. So without their support and the dedication that they have, I mean, some of these fans come to events. Say the, you know, bell time is at 7:00. They're at the event at 9 a.m. in the morning.
Ooh.
They're waiting for guys to arrive to get pictures and autographs. I mean, that's passion. You know, they all deserve credit for what we do, because without them we wouldn't have the jobs that we've had.
You know, it sounds like, you know, you've not you know, you're not really ready to completely walk away because there's so much. It's almost like you're talking in the past and the present tense at the same time.
I am, and that's the passion I feel. I'm not ready to walk away. That's for sure. You know, I needed some time, obviously, to heal my back and spend some time with my family. Before, I was doing 200 cities a year, and I was home 35 days. So, you know, that there's a huge sacrifice that you make to your family, and I also lived that myself as a kid growing up, and I understand the sacrifice that entails and what's involved in that. And I'm not ready to give it up, but, you know, times have changed, you know. Plane travel's a little bit easier. We can travel as a family, maybe. I do have an event coming up in New Kent, Virginia, at New Kent High School for Classic Pro Wrestling. That's going to be on October 15th. I'm going to be making an appearance there. And
nice.
I'm going to be bringing my family with me. And we're going to make it a family event. So we're going to go up and enjoy the day together. And, I'm definitely not ready to step away yet.
And it shows. It certainly shows in your voice. I'm just curious. I live in Virginia, but where is New Kent, Virginia? I live in, like, southwest Virginia, like over toward Winston-Salem, North Carolina. But where is New Kent? I've never heard of that.
New Kent is going to be the upper part of Virginia.
Gotcha.
I would say northeast.
Okay.
It's about 6.5 hours from Charlotte.
Jesus. We're going to have to get this guy into some Carolina promotions. Mm-hmm. Come on now. Plenty of Carolina promoters listen to this podcast. Come on. I want to see Richie Steamboat.
Well, I will be making an appearance at WrestleCade next month with my dad, which is awesome.
Cool.
You know, little father and son deal going on. There is some other bookings going on that I have that as dates get closer, we'll start talking about those and on my social media, on my Facebook page. There's several different Richie Steamboat Facebook pages that fans have made, and I really appreciate that. But you can tell which one is mine because I post a lot of things, there's a picture of me flying through the air with a WWE sign in the background. So if any of the fans are interested in checking my page out and looking what I'm up to, they're more than happy to do that and just make sure they get the right page, you know.
There's only one Richie Steamboat, y'all.
I'll tell you, I really appreciate the fan pages. But don't try and impersonate me, that's for sure. Because you can't. There's only one. And you know what, another question I've always been asked, you know, a lot of people ask me, is, you know, how are you going to follow in your father's boots? You know, Hall of Famer,
right?
One of the greatest matches of all time, Randy Savage, WrestleMania 3, you know, countless titles, been around the world a million times. How are you ever going to fill those boots? And I said, well, I got my own boots.
Exactly.
I'm not trying to fill his boots. I said, I got 10 pairs of boots up there in my closet. Ready. So, you know, I've always been a competitor, and I've always been an athlete from the age of 5. I started amateur wrestling. I won 6 state championships here in North Carolina. I was born and raised in Charlotte.
Wow.
I won a national title, amateur wrestling. I was on the U.S. Junior Olympic team. I was on the All-Star Ohio team, amateur wrestling. You know, everything that I've ever done, I've always tried to. I've given it my all, and you know, that's all that's the best advice I can give anyone is to never give up. Never let someone tell you no.
And that right there is great advice. I just have one more question, Richie, and I know I've you know a couple questions ago. I kind of, you know, asked it, but, you know, I've asked it, Bob's asked it, we've pressed you for it. You know, you kind of didn't give us a straight answer, but, you know, I'm an investigative journalist. I've got to ask again, are you making a return to the ring? And if so, when? Come on, Richie. The fans want to know.
I know. That's a question. Over the last week, I've been asked probably about 20 different times from different podcasts and reporters and things like that. And I'm sorry, but right now I'm just not going to give out that information. I wish I could tell you more, but right now I'm not gonna disclose any of that. I'm just I'm happy to be back a part of the sport, and we'll see what happens. I'll say that.
Well,
so
exactly.
With the passion that I have, it would be extremely difficult for me not to even consider it. I'll say that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I told a fib. I have to ask you one more question. I ask everybody who's been trained by George South this question. Did he pick out a nickname for you, or did he just call you Steamboat, or what?
Now, if you know George, he gives everybody a little nickname.
Right.
He gives everybody a nickname.
Right.
And he called me Little Ricky. even to this day, he calls me Little Ricky.
Oh,
and I love George to death. He's one of my best friends. And I appreciate everything that he's done for me. He helped me so much in my wrestling career up to this point, and he's always been there for me, and I've tried to be there for him, and he's just a great guy. So anytime any of you fans out there, you see a George South sign, you guys better go to that show because you might see me there.
You never know. And he wanted me, George, I talked to George via Facebook Messenger earlier today, and he wanted me to tell you that he wished he had 50 like you.
I had 50 what?
He wished he had 50 trainees like you.
Oh, thank you. Oh, man. Well, I think the wrestling business will get a lot more competitive. I'll tell you that.
Why there?
You know, and George does his training up at High Spots in Charlotte. And
I've been to a training session. It's awesome. I've not got in the ring. Don't get it twisted. I've just watched. But great.
I've been down there, and my dad has been down there early in my training days. And you know, they have a couch. It's kind of a very chill place to hang out. A lot of wrestlers come and my dad's sitting on the couch and he's watching me train, and he's teaching me how to throw an arm. George is teaching me how to throw an arm drag, and my dad is on the couch and he's trying to explain it to me. And you know, it just wasn't clicking for me. I just couldn't get that Steamboat arm drag. And he said, you know, and it, I mean, we must have done 20 or 30 of them in a row. And you know, I'm exhausted. I'm tired. I'm like, come on, Dad. You know, is there anything else you can tell me? He says, and he just gets up off the couch. He says, all right, George, here we go. Shoots George off and takes an arm drag. Shows me right there how to do it. You know, and this is a guy, my dad, that hasn't been in the ring in, I don't even remember the year that was. That was early. That was probably 2002. Hasn't been in the ring in over 10 years and threw a perfect arm drag. and I'll say it, and when I watched him do that, that helped me. That really did. And within two or three arm drags, I had it down pat.
You just needed some visual aid.
I needed that visual and maybe that little kick in the butt from Dad to say, you know, this, or like, you know, like, this is how you do it, son. You know, that
right.
kind of thing.
Right. And if the old man can do it, you can do it.
Yeah, and it was a lot of amazing stories. So I'm so thankful. It's been great. And it's not over yet, so we'll see what happens.
Well, certainly cool. Will. And, you know, you mentioned one upcoming event. What are some other upcoming events that you've got, or if you can, you know, tell us besides, you know, or, and you can go over those two that you mentioned just a minute ago.
Well, I have the event coming up. I was going to be doing a show for Tony Hunter this weekend, but because of the hurricane, that show was canceled.
I've got the event
October 15th in New Kent, Virginia, at New Kent High School, and the meet and greet starts at 5 and ends at 6:30, and bell time is at 7. I'll be at WrestleCade, and I'll also be making some further announcements of some other shows. I know I have another show. I don't have my book with me right now, but I have another show in Beech Mountain, North Carolina, coming up.
Okay, yeah. Yeah.
So I will be placing those dates on my Facebook page and updating that and getting those dates out to the fans as maybe a week or two out from the event.
Wonderful. And speaking of social media and Facebook, if a fan wanted to get in touch with you or if a promoter wanted to as well, what are your social media contacts?
I would recommend that you just message me on Facebook. Or if you know George South, you can always talk to George South. I'm in the process of setting up a special account, a Gmail account, that way I can accept promoters' bookings through that. I don't have that set up yet. But if you want to message me through Facebook or talk to George, I'm more than willing to talk with any promoters or any of my fans. I just appreciate all of them. And I still have, I think I have like 1,300 fans in a week, and I have over 1,000 requests.
Good Lord. So you're popular.
I'm trying to get through them as fast as I can. But every time I go through 100 or 200, I spend an hour doing that. It seems like another 200 of it have been added. So I think I'm falling behind a little bit here. I need to do this a little more full time.
Yeah, just a little bit. Our co-executive producer George Coles wants me to tell you that your Florida fans miss you. Hint, hint. He watched you and Chris Hero do battle down in Florida Championship Wrestling. He lives in Sebring, so he was kind of on that loop of house shows at for Florida Championship Wrestling and. And we ask all of our guests to record a little bump for us that we play at the beginning of the shows. And we always ask them to introduce themselves and, you know, say you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Radio Show. And anything else you'd want to throw in there would be fine. And you can go whenever you like.
All right. This is Richie Steamboat, and this is Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. And I'm glad to be here. And thank you to all my fans out there. Can't wait to see you at the next show.
Very cool. Very cool. Richie, thank you so much for taking time out of your evening to be with us, man. We had an absolute blast with you. Thank you so much.
We sure did. Thank
you
so much.
And anytime you guys would like to do an interview, I'd be more than happy to do it. Maybe one of these days when I got Dad over at the house, when he flies up here, we can get him on here too. That would be great.
That would be awesome.
That would be absolutely awesome. And we're going to hold you to something. If you start feeling the itch to put one of those 10 pairs of boots on, you got to let us know.
Yeah, you got to call us.
All right. Well, I will let you know. I'm sure if that time comes. It won't take very long for that to get out, but I will promise you this. You guys will be one of the first to know, all right?
Woohoo! Yay!
Very cool. Richie, thank you again so much, man.
We'll see you at WrestleCade.
Yep.
All right.
We'll see you at WrestleCade.
We'll see you then.
All right, sir. Thank you. All right.
Bye.
All right. Bye-bye. And there goes Richie Steamboat, folks. We're going to take 30 seconds to run this plug, and when we come back, we will have Holidead live for you. Hold on just a moment for us. Hey everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Laura.
Folks, Top Rope Belts is the world leader in custom designed title belts. Randy and the rest of the crew are ready to create a one-of-a-kind belt for your company or personal collection. Top Rope Belts uses 100% custom drawings, and they are the only belt maker to do all their own etching. What this means is quality from start to finish. That's right. If you're looking to be a championship title holder like Laura, look no further than Top Rope Belts. Check them out, folks. www.topropebelts.com. Very, very cool to be able to speak to Mr. Richie Steamboat, and we already have our second guest holding. I obviously don't want to keep her waiting any longer than what she already has. Folks, we're very, very excited making her podcast debut only with us on Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, all the way from California. We would like to welcome to the show Holidead. Holidead, how are you tonight?
I'm doing great. Thank you guys for having me. I got to admit, you know, I'm a little nervous. You guys are my first, so.
We're going to keep it light. We're going to keep it breezy. We're going to keep it easy. How's that sound?
Sounds good for the first time. I can handle that.
All right, very good. Obviously, with me on the other end of the line is the other co-host of the program, Laura. Laura, would you like to say hello to Holidead?
Hello there. It is a pleasure to get to talk to you, and we promise that this will be your best podcast experience ever.
I hope so. Thank you, because, you know, it's my only one technically, so.
So right now it's got to be the best.
Yeah, you know? It's going to be the best regardless. There you go.
Exactly. A memorable first-time experience. I want to kick it off and say congratulations on becoming one half of the Western States Tag Team Champions with Thunder Rosa, former show guest, this past week at NWA Vendetta Pro. Pretty cool. Saw all the pictures on it. Pretty awesome, huh?
Thank you, guys. Yeah, history right there. Like, our first title and, you know, got to be in the history books. First women to do that. So we're pretty stoked about that for sure.
Yeah. Now, your Twitter account introduces you to the world by saying wrestling demons in and out of the ring. What does that phrase say about you personally, Holidead?
It could say a couple things that I'm vaguely open, I guess. Depending on how you look at it, you might think probably a little messed up, I guess. I mean,
I would think
the wrestling demons in the ring thing is kind of self-explanatory, you know, whoever my opponent is or the ref or fans, whatever. But I don't know. I feel like we all have stuff that we're battling and fighting against. I don't choose to put it out there. I put it out there, but not in too depth in a description, you know, whether I'm battling
sure.
something mentally or the man or the establishment or whatever. I feel it shows I'm oddly enough like everybody else, but I'm just admitting it that I'm
right.
dealing with whatever it is, you know.
Kind of living on the edge, right? The fine line?
Always. That's the only way to do it.
I hear you. Recently, Lucha Underground has reintroduced us to unique and colorful characters, both male and female. You yourself are unique and colorful. Do you feel that people at first didn't know what to make of your appearance? And more specifically, what does your appearance represent in wrestling?
I think anytime I go anywhere, especially somewhere new, people are not sure what to make of the appearance. I mean, we're all human, so of course we all judge by looks, and we're not, you know, you're not sure what you're getting yourself into. But I think it's more so like my vibe that pulls people in, whether it's for better or worse, you know. And some people kind of dig the look, you know. They fool with the dark side, so I'm cool with that. As far as like appearance in wrestling, it's something different. It's not your average cookie cutter. It's, you know, not the just the all-American type look. It's very something different. I mean, it's just be yourself, whether, you know, that's something crazy or out there that people mm-hmm. won't understand, whether they will get it or not, you know. It's definitely something different that, you know, not a lot of people are same wavelength. But I'm cool. I'm cool with different. I like different a lot. You can probably tell.
Right. No, and it makes sense. I mean, the idea is to stand out, and you certainly stand out. So, you know, it works. Works for me anyway. So some of our listeners. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I cut you off. I raked your eyes. Go ahead. All you.
No, it's not about me. It's about you. Go ahead. You were going to elaborate. Go ahead.
I'm not sure where I was going with my thought. It's, okay.
Okay.
I'll let you, you know. I'm just along for the ride
okay.
here.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna pull one off the cuff because I used one of the pictures in the promotional plug for this, and I've seen a couple others of you and children, and you know, just like curiosity, and I see your curiosity, little fella. And what do the kids make of you when you are taking pictures with them? I mean, we see their looks. I think it's highly entertaining, but what do they say? What's the overall impression there?
I think the kids are actually into me. Like, it takes them a while. Like you said, they're not sure what to think about the appearance first. They're kind of like, you know, I don't know what this is exactly. I'm not sure. But, you know, it's all about vibes. And, you know, kids more than anybody, I think they can definitely recognize real. And, you know, once we get past the whole facial thing, I'm different than you. That, you know, they're pretty cool with Holidead. And I'm cool with that. Holly's kids, you know. I'm going to start calling them, I think.
Holly's kids.
I like that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That is
different
cool because kids are. They're 100% honest. They're genuine. They don't have any agenda. You know, so
right.
I think
the pictures are interesting. They usually have
a
scared face once we take the picture, and then afterwards they're pretty cool. They're hugging and everything. They want free shirts and stuff. So you know, it's not all about. They're not all terrified. They get past that, you know, and they like the dark side. They fool with it. They get it.
Everybody
cool.
likes the dark side. They have cookies there.
Yeah. He gets it too. You guys get it. You're all right with me.
Me?
Some of our listeners may not be aware that you've had the opportunity to wrestle for Stardom in Japan. What was your experience like there, and how does wrestling in Japan compare to wrestling here in the United States?
My experience in Japan, it's like a whole another realm or whatever. By the time I went to Japan, that was, like, technically my first, like, one of my first experiences outside of where I had, like, originally started training. So I pretty much, like, went from training to on to Stardom. Like, in Japan is my first kind of experience out in the real wrestling world. And I don't know, it's a way to grow up fast, if you will. People talk a lot about strong style here. Like, that is the legit ultimate strong style of all strong styles. Like, those girls go, they don't hold nothing back, and it's like every piece of passion they have for it, like, they put it all out there. They don't hold anything back, and I love it.
Very cool. Now, it's been announced that you and Thunder Rosa will be returning to Japan for the Goddess of Stardom Tag League 2016. How important is this tour of Japan for you?
It's very important, especially, you know, we just won the Western State, NWA Western State Tag Team Championship. Going in there, I mean, like, this is the second time for both of us, so we kind of know what to expect. Like, we've been there once. We stepped up our game since the last time they've seen us, and I think they're just going to see a whole new, like, beast in both of us. I don't know whether they're ready for it or not, but I know we both feel like we have a lot to prove to people. I don't think we're necessarily deserving of everything, but, you know, we work hard for everything that we've accomplished to this point, and just going there just to prove again, like, you know, we deserve where we're at, and we're coming for any and everybody, and we're out to make a name, and we will do that for sure.
Very cool. We're behind you 100%, that's for sure. Laura, go ahead.
Sisters.
They have Twisted Sisters, that's right.
Curious. I'm going to ask a question off the cuff, but it's what was your favorite part of Japan? Japan is like, it's on my bucket list, and I want to go so badly. I'm just curious, what was the best part about it for you?
I mean, for me as a wrestler, and this, what I love, my passion, for me, the best part was just somebody just actually taking me over and having me in their company. All I had to do over there was wrestle and train. For me, that's like That's all I got to do, wrestle and train. This is it. I love it. But the fans over there, they are of a different breed. If they like you, they like your work, then they want to take you out, spend time with you. I got a lot of free beverages. I'll just say that. So the fans are very grateful. They're very grateful, and I appreciate their appreciativeness. But if not going as a wrestler, they do have a lot of cool temples. You can go get your zen on and all that stuff. So that they have a lot of the culture, and I just enjoy it a lot. I think you should definitely make that trip happen. If you can come this October, I'd recommend it, see if we can get you on a Stardom show or something.
Heck yeah!
Yeah, put that sister shirt on.
I'm down.
For you.
Heck
all right,
yeah.
Well, we got to work on that. We got to work on making that happen.
We'll work on that, too, yeah. I mean, I can't imagine anything better than, going to Japan and watching you wrestle, and wow, I mean, yeah. We gotta work on this. You and I have to.
All right, I'm putting it on my to-do list on the side. We'll talk after this. So
all right,
we'll make it happen.
We'll make it happen. Well,
cool.
As of late, you've been all over the place wrestling. Various opponents from California, Texas, Arizona, and beyond. And your schedule has been, to say the least, busy. Were you prepared for the reaction that you've received so far from promotion to promotion?
Reaction, as far as fans, from the promoters?
I guess from the promoters and saying, hey, I saw you here, we got to get you over here,
Mm-hmm. From a promoter's perspective, I wasn't necessarily expecting anything. I just knew, I came back from Japan, I got to keep the ball rolling, I got to keep momentum rolling, I got to get myself out there. And it just takes, one or two good bookings. It's just about giving your all once you're out there. And that's all I can do. And if they look at it and they say, I like this, I like what you're doing, I want you to come back, cool. Honestly, from fans or promoters, I don't expect anything from anybody. I have to go do my job. And hopefully they like what I'm putting out there, and they want to bring me back. And so far, that's been the case. Just for my training, from a wrestler just to being professional and all that aspect. So, I guess I have some pretty good training, so that helps, I can say.
Most certainly. It's great to have a building foundation and to build upon.
Definitely. And I'm just trying to build here and just continue to grow and hopefully I'll have me a big tree somewhere, and that'll stay rooted for a good time.
It certainly sounds like you are on your way to doing that. When someone uses the phrase, quote unquote, women's wrestling, what's the first thing that comes into your mind?
It's hard to just pinpoint it at one thing. So many things. Women's wrestling, just people that have paved the way, the Luna Vachon's, Fabulous Moolahs, those people that have allowed us to be here. And just currently, with everything that's going on now with, WWE and Lucha Underground, there's, a whole women's revolution, if you will. Women are being seen not just because of what they're wearing or objectified. It's more about the wrestling, especially in WWE. They're highlighting that a lot now. And in Lucha Underground, where they have the women in the same division, and they're competing with men, it's just a lot of things are changing, we're still, still a man's, it's a man's world, to quote James Brown, but we're making strides and I think of the whole, the whole women's revolution that's going on, and it's doing a lot of good for us and building, some good things back.
Right. And dropping the name Diva from the WWE product had to have, helped as well.
I think that just showed you they're going in another direction, that
right.
The Divas division, it was something specifically they had shaped for a certain type of women. And, they just said, all right, we got to go in another direction. It's women's wrestling. Because, the word diva can be associated with, so many negative thoughts. People say,
right.
Oh, she's a diva. It's not necessarily a good thing, depending on who you ask. So, I think that's definitely help. All right, they're okay, we want to focus on the wrestling. It's not necessarily about attitudes and all this stuff. So it's definitely a good start,
I think so too. And, you know, last night's main event on Raw certainly proved that.
Right, and I think
not
that's
last
like
night,
what
but the night before. Sorry.
Right, and I think that's like the second time that, you know, the women have closed out of Raw. So like,
right.
That's, you know, it's saying a lot. You know, we're making strides, but it's still a ways to go. But any progress is good progress, I guess.
I totally agree. And, you know, we're talking about women in wrestling, of course. And let's discuss Thunder Rosa, who's been a former guest on this very program. You have what some would say described as a twisted relationship, thus the Twisted Sisters moniker, your sisters, tag team partners, and opponents. What's been the highlight and the low light of that relationship?
Well, highlight obviously has to be recently. As you guys mentioned earlier, we just won the NWA Vendetta Pro Western States Tag Team Championships. We haven't, you know, honestly, we haven't been tagging that long, but, you know, we've really been trying to build something, and just to have our first championship and, like, one associated with, you know, caliber of NWA, like, and to be, like, the first women to do that, like, sorry if I'm saying like a lot, but, yeah, that is, like, pretty awesome. Like, that's obviously the highest moment of the relationship thus far. As far as a low light, honestly, I don't have a specific low light. She might, you know, I don't know if she'll say different, but no, I mean, like, we're extremely close, and like, we have a relationship where, like, we're bluntly open with each other about everything. So we don't always agree. We do bump heads. We don't always see eye to eye, but we put it out there in the open and we discuss it. It might not be pretty talks, but like, we put it out there and we put it to bed, and we're good. So, you know, knock on wood or something, but so far, you know, no real downers for us. We're open with each other. That is my sister, you know. I hurt somebody for her, so we're tight like that. I don't have anything bad to say about her. I don't know if she might say different. I don't know, you know, but so far so good.
Don't you think that more women need to be that way with one another, just to be open and say, hey, you know, whatever, instead of like, you know, being catty or, you know.
I totally agree. I mean, I don't think our relationship would be as strong as it is if we didn't say, hey, I thought you did was messed up, or hey, that bothered me, you know. Because we put everything out there. We don't have anything to say behind each other's back, you know. And if we hear something about the other, we bring it up to each other. I mean, I think that would squash a lot of things and just put everybody on a level playing field of how we all feel about each other, and just being adults or whatever. But I mean, with any business or with anything, there's some cattiness that follows. So just gotta try to deal with it the best we can.
Exactly. But it is great to hear that the two of you are open with one another. And if you're going to be, you know, wrestling and tag partners, you got to have that trust too. So, you know.
Absolutely. We live together. We, to quote her, we poop in the same toilet. So, you know.
That sounds right.
That's right.
Yeah. That, you know. Yeah. Her quote will be a little more explicit, but I don't know if you guys are PG or not, so I don't want to go all out
there.
Not
the PG era.
Okay. Okay. I wasn't sure. I just, you know.
No.
It was all wrong.
That's cool.
Okay.
That's funny.
Oh, my. I can't wait till she hears this. When Bob and I first started talking and interviewing women wrestlers on the West Coast about 3 years ago, we could count the number of credible wrestlers on two hands, basically. And now we are hearing so many names, so many more names than ever before. What do you credit that to?
I don't know if it can be credited to one particular thing or person. I mean, just on my personal experiences, it's just other people in the business giving the younger people opportunities. I'll name drop a couple. Cheerleader Melissa, for example. You know, she didn't know me too much, but you know, I reached out to her and she pretty much got me the opportunity to go to Japan. She didn't, you know, I could have flopped. She didn't know if I would have shit the bed or whatever, but she put her neck and her name out there for me to go, and it was up to me to do something with it. I would say the same for Thunder Rosa. You know, when I got back, like, she wanted to work with me. You know, she put her, you know, some fillers out there, like, hey, I want a match with Holiday, like, trying to get me book places. And I can say the same thing for, like, there's another show coming up this Friday, Sabotage in Covina, California. I mean, there's some, you know, not a lot of names on there are people that you might know, and it's another opportunity that somebody's, you know, putting out there to showcase people that might not always get known in recognition. Because sometimes, unfortunately, you know, one or two names can get out there and it can be refiltered over and over, and nobody's
right.
really looking to give the other person the opportunity. It's a bad kind of way in the business sometimes like that. So, I mean, for me personally, just on my experiences, there's a lot of people that – there's a handful of people, I'll say, that have, you know, went out of their way and said, let's give her a chance. And I mean, when somebody gives you the chance, it's up to you to be ready, and you have to do
exactly.
your part. You know, they can only get you to the dance, to the ball. You got to dance once you get there. Dance your ass off.
Dance your ass off, most certainly. well, you know, is the East Coast ready for Holidead?
I don't know if they're ready. Holidead is ready for the East Coast. I'll say that, you know. Just like Japan, I'll say the East Coast compared to California or just the West Coast in general, it's a whole nother beast, it's a whole nother realm. Like,
right.
you know, and I know it's a different body of wrestling over there. Wrestling fans over there are probably a little more hardcore than over here, I'd have to say. So, you know, I'm sure they're a little tougher, the crowd there, but I'm like, I don't know if they're ready for, you know, Holiday or not, but I'm definitely ready to make my way over there given the opportunity. It's definitely something. It's not even on my bucket list. It's just on, like, near future. Got to do this very soon list. So,
we need to talk to Queens of Combat.
Yeah, we need to talk to Josie and Jake for sure.
Certainly. We need to talk to them and get you at a Queens of Combat show. Love to see you.
I'm not opposed to that at all. You know, I'm putting all this on my list. We got to get you to Japan. And you're going to talk to Queens of Combat. It's going on the
exactly.
list.
Exactly.
So.
You stick
uh-huh.
with me. Yeah, I'll get you.
We're going to go far, see? Yeah.
That's right. You stick
this
with
is,
me, you go
this is the best. This is the best podcast I've ever done, see? You're right. This is the best podcast. Literally.
I told you. I keep my promise.
You're a woman of your word. I gotta give it to you. You're winning me. You're winning me over. You are winning me over. I can't lie. I'm enjoying myself. Going well. Going well.
That's awesome. Great to hear that. One last question for me. Do you have aspirations to perhaps travel east, of course, what we just talked about, and, you know, and see what the competition or the response to you would be here? Of course, we just talked about Queens Combat and, of course, their shine down in Florida. But, you know, I would love to see, you know, maybe you and Jessica Havoc go at it.
I'm up for that. I'm always up for a challenge. There's so many good names out there that I would love to go against just to prove myself that I can hang in there with these ladies. You know, anything that comes my way, I'm definitely down for. I'm slowly, you know, inching my way. Like, I just got to get across that Texas line. You know,
Texas is
I've
a big
made
state.
It that far.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've made it that far. I haven't passed that Texas line onto the other side of the coast, but I mean there's so many girls out there and there's so much good talent on the East Coast. Like you said, there you could count before on three, you know, the women in
right.
the West Coast. But I mean I still feel like there's maybe only a handful or two of us literally out here as compared to the East Coast, where, you know, they have all women feds over there. Because they have that
right.
much talent. So, I mean, that is part of the plan, you know. You know, we'll see how it turns out after this next tour in Japan. You know, I'm definitely going to try to make my way over there.
That's one of her favorite words. You'll come to find out. You mentioned it briefly, Holiday. You are scheduled to be a part of Sabotage Wrestling this Friday, October 7th in Covina, California. And we've had our eyes on this event for some time because I believe that this could be a launching pad for a regular all-women's card or all-women's promotion in California. And this has ramifications in three countries. What are your thoughts on this event? I mean, how big is this for the wrestling scene on the West Coast?
I mean, I think it's big for the wrestling scene, not just on the West Coast, but in general and in women's wrestling. Again, like I mentioned, you know, some of these people, you know, everybody might not know, but again, it's like someone that they want to say, okay, hey, all these ladies, they don't always get, you know, noticed or attention, but they're out here. And this is, you know, this is somebody bringing this, like, hey, this is your opportunity. This is your chance to get showcased. But now they get, you know, everybody, we all got to show up and do our part to say, hey, like, you know, there is something going on out here. There are, you know, other opportunities for women. And we got, like you said, women coming from all over, Mexico, Japan, Italy, Canada, like, U.S., women from Texas, everywhere. Like, I think it's, again, it's part of that, you know, whole women's wrestling revolution that's happening now, not just with WWE, Lucha Underground, like, and all of the independent scene. Now, like, I'm not sure, like, what number all women's show this is, but I know I've been a part, you know, like, of a lot this year, and just from what I've been told, you know, that's not a normal thing, like, as far as, like, how many has happened in California, like, this year.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a great opportunity, and, like, Brian Cervantes, the promoter putting on the show, you know, he's a good guy, and he's always wanting to, like, wanting to showcase people that seen a lot or not in the spotlight or just haven't been given that chance, and this is the chance for everybody to step their game up, and, you know, I'm pretty sure, like, the show will do well, and then there'll be another Sabotage, too, and can grow from there, and this can be, like, another Shine or Shimmer or Queens of Combat, another all-women's promotion to add, like, hey, this is another place for women to go rep work and show what they can do.
We're definitely going to keep our eye on the event and certainly want to wish you the best of luck at the event. If you had a parting message for those whom support you and maybe those that don't even, what would that message be?
To those that support me, the dark side is the best side. Hashtag it all the time. Those that support, they know and they're about that life, so I don't have to say much to that. You know, thank you for those that do support and rocking with me, and I hope you remain. For those that don't support, I don't know why. If you haven't seen me and you don't support, then give me a chance. Check out some of my stuff on YouTube. If you have seen me and you're not a supporter, the most I can say is, as far as me and wrestling are concerned, we're pretty much married. And as far as that, I'm kind of old school, so it's like that. I don't plan on going anywhere. So, you know, if you're not a supporter, like, you know, stick around. Maybe I can win you over. Whether, you know, as long as I get something out of you, whether it's a good reaction or a bad reaction, as long as you're not monotone. If I got you pulled in for good or bad, then I'm okay with that. So I'll be here. I don't plan on going anywhere. So, you know, I think I got time to win them over then.
Absolutely. Well. For fans that would like to purchase Holidead merchandise, how can they do that?
I'm not up with all of the times yet. I don't have a fancy website or anything like that, but they can definitely, you know, find a Facebook page, Holidead, Holidead. Feel free to message me. You know, I do ship out anything you need like that, or on Twitter. Unfortunately, that's all I got at the moment. One day I will get a nice fancy website. You can purchase stuff from there. But until then, feel free to contact me via Facebook or Twitter, and I'll set you up good.
And the Twitter address is @Holidead, and we'll put that up as well. I know that,
yes.
You know, obviously you've got the show coming up on Friday, October the 7th. Where else are you going to be at coming up so that if fans want to come out and see you, where will you be?
I did just have a show get canceled, unfortunately. So, beyond Friday, pretty much getting ready for Japan, October 19th.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Rosa and I will be heading out there, and we'll be there until Christmas Eve. So, I think this Friday may be the last time they catch me in the States.
Yeah.
Most likely. So, you know, so time to buy plane tickets out to Covina, California. It's going to be a great show. It's totally worth it, you know.
Right.
I know people that stay in L.A. If you need somewhere to be housed, we can find a couch for you. But if not, after that, we'll be in Japan. Don't know all of the cities yet, but somewhere in Japan, Stardom, you can I believe they have a website. You can subscribe to their channel, catch all that action. So California, well, Japan, that is where I'll be at the remainder of the year.
We certainly, obviously, want to wish you and Thunder Rosa the best of luck in the Goddess of Stardom tag tournament out there, and hope that you have safe travels and great shows and all that good stuff. And the last thing that we ask all of our guests to do, Holidead, if you could record an audio bump for us, if you could say something like, "This is Holidead, and you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show," and you could go whenever you'd like.
Get ready. This is Holidead, and you're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. The dark side is the best side. How was that?
Very good.
Was that good for you guys?
That was absolutely fabulous. Absolutely fabulous. Holidead, thank you so much for coming on the show tonight. We hope you had a great experience with us.
Yes.
It was the best. It was the best podcast I've ever done. You guys are awesome. I hope I didn't breeze through that too fast for my first time, you know.
No,
did
everything
wonderfully.
Was spot on.
Yes.
Thank you so much
Most
for being
certainly.
On. We certainly
no
appreciate
problem.
It.
Thank you. And we got to get
you
out to Japan,
good...
and you remember
yes.
that. I haven't forgot. You can come too, Bob. You can come too. It's all good.
Exactly.
Thank you. So I appreciate the invitation. I'll tag along.
No
thank
problem.
You.
We'll be waiting for you guys. Thank
That's
you
right.
guys so much.
You're very welcome.
All right.
All right.
Good evening. Bye now. And there goes Holidead. How cool was that?
Very cool. I like her a whole lot.
Like her a lot too, and give a little backstory for people that may or may not know. Had been working diligently to get Holidead on the show. We had heard so much about her through Facebook and social media, a lot of the posts coming through, and kept seeing pictures of her up with Thunder Rosa, whether it was, you know, at shows that they happened to be on, cards they happened to be on, or fighting one another. You know, and that's the other thing. It would just awesome. We'd wanted to have her on for a while, and it took a minute, but we felt obligated to be able to bring you wrestlers not only from the East Coast, but from the West Coast. And I put it out on Twitter here just a few minutes ago. If you have not looked at that Sabotage Wrestling flyer, this is a big show, and, you know, and I've put it out on social media a couple times, and we've talked about it a little bit on the program. This is a pretty big deal, and it's kind of like what she was saying. You have people coming in that are going to be represented from Japan, from Mexico, from Europe, obviously here in the United States. It's a pretty big deal. This has ramifications that will obviously be carried back over to Japan when her and Thunder Rosa travel over there. But there's other things that are going to be happening as well in Mexico. So this is a pretty big deal. So I hope that people that are fans of not only women's wrestling, but wrestling in general, are paying attention to it, because it needs to be paid attention to.
Most certainly does. I wish I could hop a jet on over to Cali to see that Friday. Wow.
It's a pretty awesome pretty awesome event. I was just pulling the flyer back up here. Obviously, Holidead, Thunder Rosa, Taya from Lucha Underground is going to be there. Ruby Reyes is part of that show. Sage Sin is part of that show.
Wow.
There's quite a few people that are listed on that show. So I would.
And how many of them have
you.
Been on this show?
There are a few on that flyer.
Quite a few,
That have been on this particular program, and obviously it'd be remiss if we didn't go back and say thanks again to Richie Steamboat for coming on the show.
And thank you, George South, for helping us.
Yes.
Get that.
Yes, thank you, George. Certainly appreciate George South. I don't know. I've just got this weird feeling in my gut that. That it's just a matter of time.
He talks like a man who is on the verge of making a life-changing decision.
Yeah, it sounds that way to me. It was kind of like what you said. You know, you're talking in the past tense and the present tense, all in the same sentence.
Right, it's
you
the same thing, you know?
Yeah, you know, you've got 10 pairs of boots. that are gathering dust. So,
you know,
yeah, you can take of it what you want to, listeners, but I'm telling you that I feel that it's only a matter of time before you see Richie Steamboat back in a wrestling ring in some capacity, in some way, shape, or form.
He's going
to be back in wrestling.
That's what I feel as well. I am going to have to sell another body part, like maybe a lung, because I'm not missing a chance to get my picture with Richie Steamboat and Ricky Steamboat. Come on now.
Yeah, well, you know, maybe it can be one of those scenarios where we can just like get like a side picture.
Oh, no. I can't be doing a side picture.
You can't do a side picture.
Mm-mm. Oh. No. See, Cedric tried that side hug shit with me. It shows. No. Mm-mm. And speaking of Cedric, great segue there. See what I did there, mm-hmm. ladies and gentlemen. High spots, cha-ching. Cedric Alexander's exit interview. And if you have not seen, they did a little, they put out a little added bonus footage, and it's free that you can see. And it's Cedric talking about his family showing up at shows. And now John has told me of Cedric's mother's belief in kayfabe. And I had never seen it until that match with Samoa Joe. She throws a chair, and she keeps throwing chairs, and I'm like, holy shit, this lady's going to hit him. But he flinched, she didn't budge, he just kept on talking. But, that's the funniest stuff, and I'm sure I'm really interested to see that DVD and see all, you know, what he says, and I think that we're all still kind of, I don't want to say in shock, but it's all still surreal to see Cedric in a WWE ring on Raw, on NXT, tearing it up, which we all knew that he would, but it's still a little surreal to see someone that, you know, you've to at a show or, you know, he's stolen your phone, things of that nature. And now he's like, you know, sky's the limit for him, you know. It truly, truly is. But, you know, we're just, you know, trying out for helping out High Spots, cha-ching. With that exit interview. It looks like it's going to be awesome. But you can go to highspots.com, cha-ching, and find that, because I think they're taking, I think maybe pre-orders. I'm not sure if it's actually, you know, ready to be shipped or not. But still some great stuff. Still some absolute, I can't wait to see it myself, just to see what he says, because I'm sure. If you just to watch his mother go at it, I think she was throwing she was throwing shit at Rhett Titus one time, because they were this was when Tyshawn was running TWX, and he had brought out a rope and had hung Cedric from the top rope with like a bull rope.
Right.
And, you know, that didn't go over too well with Cedric's mama.
I'm sure it didn't.
So, but anyway, I just want to throw that out there. And so, Bob, WrestleCade.
Yeah.
David, who's grown to, like, monumental proportions as far as height goes. So we're going to be there at WrestleCade. Bob and I will be. Miss Allie Parker will be there representing Live from the Armory. I want everybody to come by and say hello to Miss Allie, because it is a rare treat for her to be on the East Coast. And if you have never seen anything by her, you can YouTube it, staple at Championship Wrestling from Hollywood for a long time. This is really, we've had her on the show twice, a really incredible story that she has. And getting back into the ring necessarily wrestling, but the lingerie fights, you know, and tough as nails, serious. But, yeah, I want everybody to come by, see Miss Allie, and see me and Bob, because I'm sure we'll be around the table, you know, at some point after we've met everybody and their mother. And Bob has, you know, put his house on for the third mortgage, because this is your third replicate, right? So you've had to mortgage your house three times. It's the struggle is real, folks, okay?
Yeah, Tracy and Brian have went all out, all the people, all the good people at WrestleCade. And obviously, you want to go to WrestleCade.com to be able to get the schedule and the tickets and all that other good stuff. So definitely want to do that. Wanted to throw this out here because we didn't mention this, and I don't know why, probably because we got caught up in a bunch of other stuff. The Live from the Armory Wrestling t-shirt is back. And
yes,
I just put the link out. It is back. It is on Pro Wrestling Tees, folks. You can go to ProWrestlingTees.com. You can also go to our Twitter account, at From the Armory, and I just put that link up. And you can now be the proud owner and wearer and supporter of the Live from the Armory Wrestling Show t-shirt. So make sure you go to Pro Wrestling Tees, go to the link on the at From the Armory Twitter address or on Facebook from our official page, and I think on the fans page as well. That link is up there too. And order your shirt today because you need to.
We're over, Bob. We made it. We made it to Pro Wrestling Tees. We're over.
Yep, we're on ProWrestlingTees.com, courtesy of FNX Network. Now, to talk a little bit of TNA, because there's been a lot of speculation, a lot of rumor, a lot of innuendo about TNA being for sale, so on and so forth. The very first thing that everybody had been asking or wanted to know was, who funded the pay-per-view and who's funded the tapings this week? Well, I can tell you right now that Billy Corgan flat-out refused to fund the pay-per-view because he wanted to be... He wanted to have ample compensation behind of it, and he was dissatisfied with what was being offered to him as far as a payback or a return on it. I have been told that the Bound for Glory pay-per-view and the tapings this week subsequently have been funded by a third party. Now, as soon as I say that, obviously everybody says, it's Vince McMahon. Wrong. It's not Vince McMahon. It is another minority shareholder within TNA. There is more than one shareholder in TNA. It's not just Dixie and it's not just Billy. There are other people. Now, some people think that it was Dixie's dad, Bob Carter. That's been kind of the rumor, that he slid in some money at the last minute. I can't confirm or deny that, because it was told to me that the Carter family does not want to sink any more money into TNA. They just don't. They don't want to do it. From what I understand, Dixie does want to sell TNA. What she wants to sell, actually, is her portion or her share of TNA, which is valued at around $4 million. But the problem with that is that there is also a debt incurrence that is involved for having other people pay for tapings and so on and so forth. TNA is also involved currently in a lawsuit against Eric Bischoff's production company, to which they own money too.
Right.
A lot of people have speculated that Vince McMahon and Dixie Carter have been talking, that the WWE is going to buy TNA. I have been told that Vince McMahon and Dixie Carter did in fact have a phone conversation, but Dixie Carter called Vince McMahon. It wasn't the other way around. And from what I have been told, Vince McMahon is not interested in buying TNA. He would like to have the library, but is not willing to buy a company that is currently in debt, that has pending lawsuits. The legalities that are involved here could become intertwined and crazy, from what I've been told.
With Eric Bischoff.
Exactly, and others. I think what you're going to see is I think you're going to see a lot of infighting, a lot of things that are going to have to pan out. And I think that's been the big sticking point, is that Corgan would buy Dixie's share, but he wants her to assume a portion of a percentage of the debt that they already owe, and she's not willing to do that. She wants to sell and walk away clean, and it's just not going to happen. So then it was brought up, well, didn't TNA have a contract with Sony 6 for an alleged $60 million spread over 6 to 8 years emanating from India? Now, if you remember, we talked about this at the beginning of the year, that this was TNA's saving grace, this contract, this deal. Dixie and several of the other management went to India with a lot of fanfare, but yet, when they came back, there's been no mention of that contract. I've been told that they did not draw enough viewers in order for Sony 6 to say that this is a viable contract for us. The tour of India was postponed.
Right.
And no, nothing else has been reported on it. Now, I have not been able to get any definite viewership numbers in India. Nobody can seem to find them. That's the other thing.
No Nielsen over there, huh?
There's no coverage on it. There's no nothing. It's like they just went over and for a visit and came back and that was it.
Maybe that's what it was. I mean, what it ended up to be.
I think that's what it ended up to be. I think that Sony 6 had an escape clause in the contract and they backed out. Now, the last thing really is that, you know, people want to know what is going to happen with TNA. Again, it was reported that Monday, Dixie Carter was supposed to have a meeting with management and with the talent to let them know what the future of TNA was or is. I have been told that that meeting never took place and that this has always been Dixie's fallback line. We're going to have a meeting, we're going to talk about it, and so on and so forth. Folks, to be the long and the short of it is simply this, and I believe my source. I honestly think that you're going to see TNA end up in some type of mitigating lawsuit, some type of debt receivership. I just don't think that there's going to be a legal way that Billy Corgan can buy and get what he wants and what all the other parties want. I do not believe that the WWE will be buying TNA. I think they're going to wait for the dust to settle and then come in and buy the library if they want to. They're taping at Orlando, hopefully this entire week, given the given the set of the weather that's going on. This set of tapings will carry them through the end of the year. And after that, folks, there's a giant question mark.
It's anybody's guess.
It pretty much is. Typically what ends up happening after the beginning of the year, they go for the Maximum Impact tour overseas, they go to England.
Right.
So, and I have yet to see anything announced about that. I think that they're just going to get through this week of tapings, and I think everybody's going to sit back, and you've got basically 2 months, maybe 2.5 months to figure out what it is that's going to happen. Long and short of it is, it's a giant question mark. But I would not look to see Shane McMahon standing in the TNA ring doing the live feed like they did with WCW. Hey, Dad, guess what I just bought? That's not going to happen. In my opinion, it won't happen.
We've talked about this a couple of years ago, and this is how long this has been going on, is there's really no incentive except for the library. And I don't think that's like a huge incentive for Vince to buy it. There's no incentive for them to buy TNA because he's cherry-picked most of the good talent already. I mean, you've got Bobby Roode down in NXT. Austin Aries has wrestled. There's rumors of Eric Young wrestling for NXT. I mean, you know, I'm not sure how many other people, you know, Mike Bennett, I'd love to see him in a WWE ring. I would love to see Moose. And let me just say something about Moose really quickly. He looks much more comfortable and at home in TNA than he ever did in Ring of Honor. I always thought he was kind of, I don't want to say gun shy, but it was just something that wasn't there in Ring of Honor that's obviously happening in TNA for him. And it's I just want to wish him the best, because Moose is just this really nice guy who, you know, he's just out there living his dream. You know, he's had, he's very lucky. He's been able to live two dreams, you know, and not trying to get off the subject too much, but the Hall of Fame ceremony for Gail Kim was absolutely wonderful. It was great to see Austin Kong and Taryn Terrell and Christy Hemme. I really, for me, there for a while, that feud that Gail and Austin Kong had was TNA for me, because that's what I was tuning in for, because they had knockdown dragouts, and Gail just gave it, you know, everything that Kong dished out, Gail gave right back to her. And I really think that Gail will go down in history as one of the best women wrestlers ever.
But it showed on social media that the number of people from various promotions congratulating her on the Hall of Fame, you know, induction. And, you know, even Jim Ross, you know, had mentioned something.
Right.
And, you know, it just goes to show that you know, she is considered in high regard, no matter what, you know, crossing, you know, promotional lines or crossing wrestling lines. She's that highly thought of. She's that highly thought of. You know, and you mentioned, you know, about, you know, WWE plucking away certain talents, and people were like, well, but Bob, they just signed so-and-so to a contract. Folks, the contracts that these people are being signed to are not ironclad contracts. That day of, I remember there was, at one point in time, if I'm not mistaken, AJ Styles had three different contracts with TNA, you know, that were signed guaranteed dates and all this other stuff back when they were traveling. And he was actually being paid for more dates than they were even scheduled to run on. That's how goofy their contract system was. These people were being paid, or their contracts are, in accordance with their appearances, because these other people are still wrestling at other promotions. It's not like they're locked into a no-compete clause.
Right.
They're allowed to compete other places. So don't get it turned around that just because TNA says that somebody's under contract doesn't mean that they're in a no-competition contract, because that's not the case. There are
some... I got two words for you. Caleb Conley.
Yeah, Caleb Conley. So, yeah, I think that you're just going to have to ride this out. I would not put a lot of faith or stock into a lot of the stuff that we've been seeing and reading. It's just more internet fodder, stuff to keep things, you know, stirred up. And ultimately, and this is the, you know, the end of it, is that if TNA ceases to exist, the wrestling community has lost out.
Certainly
good,
has.
Bad, or indifferent, whether you liked TNA or whether you didn't, it's not so much that it was competition for the WWE, it was another outlet for wrestlers to show their talents and an alternative to what's being shown.
Exactly. That's why I started watching it, because it wasn't WWE. You know, when I first started watching, Sting came on the scene. He was with Joe. Samoa Joe, and Samoa Joe was in the X Division, tearing it up. And that six-sided ring, which I know is, you know, according to AJ Styles, a lot harder to bump in. It was just different. The whole thing was different. It was good to see, you know, I know a lot of people shit on Jeff Jarrett, but it was good to see him back on TV. And it was good to see, you know, America's Most Wanted. And see James Storm get his start, and see Bobby Roode and Eric Young and Team Canada, and and you know, later on, see Jim Cornette, you know, acting as man, you know, like the president or the commissioner or whatever they had him doing, and that was just golden. I thought that was the best stuff. And even when, you know, Team 3D came in at the beginning of it, before it got all convoluted and everything, it was just good stuff going on. And it was, you know, people like Austin Aries, which I hadn't seen him in Ring of Honor, but I thought, God, this guy is awesome. and AJ. I mean, good Lord. And we've talked about this before.
What kills me is just think of all the people that you have named and others that we haven't named that have been in and out of the doors in TNA, both in front of the camera and behind the scenes, and we're still at this point.
Right.
We're still at this point. Think of all the people.
Another two words for you. Young Bucks.
Yeah.
Generation Me. Didn't have a clue what to do with them. And, I mean, can you imagine if they had just let them go? Every other promotion has let them do? Good God.
Yeah.
You know, the Bullet Club could be in TNA right now. I'm not saying the Young Bucks would, you know, single-handedly save TNA, but, I mean, the possibilities are just endless.
That will be the final chapter of the book, that when it's all done, the documentary, that will be the last chapter. It would have been the endless possibilities, because that's exactly
what
I think
been.
Of. Yeah, what could have been. Obviously, want to thank Richie Steamboat for being on the show. Want to thank Holidead for being on the show. We'll go on and announce next week's guest, tentatively scheduled to appear next week. Dominique Fabiano will be with us.
Woo-hoo!
And the other half of the Heat Seekers.
I can't wait.
Mr. Elliot Morey will be with us next
Woo-hoo!
Week. So we'll get to talk to them about some wrestling. Anything you want to add before we call it an evening?
Well, again, we'd like to thank George South for helping us facilitate that interview with Richie Steamboat.
Thank you, George.
And would love to also thank Holly Dead for being on. That was just such a great time. I enjoyed talking to her so much. Felt like, you know, we've been friends. You know, it was just kind of like two friends, you know, three friends talking, you know. And you know, we'd like to thank all of our listeners and Richie Steamboat for coming on and talking to us. And I'm excited. I'm excited about what the future holds for him. Real excited.
Yeah, me too. Folks, we thank you very much for listening tonight, however you've listened to the show and wherever you've listened to it at. If you've listened as we record it live on Blog Talk Radio, whether or not you catch us on the FNX network, if you listen to us on iTunes or on Stitcher, we certainly appreciate your support. We'll be back here next Wednesday night at 7 o'clock Eastern Time. And remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. Have a good week. We'll see you next week.
Been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Radio Show. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. And you can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
You've waited all year, and this Saturday, it's finally here. Old Navy's famous $1 flip-flops are back for just one day only. Polish up your petties and hurry in for flip-flops for the whole family for just $1. This Saturday only at Old Navy and OldNavy.com. Valid 6/24, limit 10. Solid colors only. You've waited all year, and this Saturday, it's finally here. Old Navy's famous $1 flip-flops are back for just one day only. Polish up your petties and hurry in for flip-flops for the whole family for just a buck. This Saturday only at Old Navy and OldNavy.com. Valid 6/24, limit 10. Solid colors only.